myself, the co-chair for the round table. And Shirley, please come in. I'd like you to say a few little words about this event.
Oh, well, I want to tell you thank you all for coming. It's so good to see you. I'm so glad the weather changed and that we had all the seasons. And Shirley mostly helped with the decorations. So that she did the decorations. Did you want to say something else?
It's a pizza with onions and anchovies. We have two types of bakery, and salad and swans. Hopefully you'll enjoy it.
Thank you so much.
It's a French.
Yes,
that's
French.
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 Thank you very much, ladies. For those who haven't been to this event before, the ladies always do an amazing job of preparing special food to match the opera that we're doing, okay? So now I'd like for the cast to go down the line, starting with their director. Each of them are gonna introduce themselves and tell you just a little bit about themselves.
Hello, my name is James Marble. I'm the stage director. I was born and raised here in New Orleans. I actually saw my first opera at the age of 7. It was The Masked Ball with Carlo Berganzi, singing the tenor role. And my mother and father are huge opera lovers, and so they've had season tickets ever since I've been alive, and I've attended probably 60 or more operas at the New Orleans Opera from the time I was very, very young. It is a tremendous pleasure to be here. I studied violin with Victor Scheuchet, who is a violinist with the New Orleans Symphony Orchestra, and have had a love of the arts all my life that was fostered and nurtured here in New Orleans. I'm very proud to be from here. I love the city more than any other place in the world and couldn't be happier to be back. So thank you for having me.
Hello everybody. I'm Gabrielle. I'm Violetta. I'm French. I come from of the south of French, of France, Albi. It's the city famous because we have the painter Toulouse-Lautrec.
Ah, yes.
I come from a family of artists, and I began the music at 5 years old. First by the flute, and after cello. This city, because a lot of people told me it's the most beautiful. beautiful city in the United States. And, so.
We agree with you.
Hi, I'm Daniel Montenegro. I'm from Southern California. I didn't grow up by a family that listened to opera or classical music. Mostly Mexican rancheras and mariachi. I did grow up singing. I joined the choir pretty much for an easy grade. And I loved it, and I was good, and all my friends were there, so I stayed in choir. This was in junior high, and in high school I stayed in choir. But it wasn't until my last year in high school, my senior year, that I saw my first opera. Just a fluke. I got a free ticket, so I said, why not? And I went, and it was in Los Angeles, and it was Pagliacci and Plácido Domingo singing, and that was it. And I remember the night very clearly. I was way up in the balcony with obstructed view, and I don't know, I just, gosh, you know, I want to try to do that. And I asked my choir director, and, you know, how do they sing like that with all that passion? And, you know, their voice is so huge. And so, well, you know, it's not what we do here, but you have to study and you know, maybe find a private teacher. And that week I found one in Orange County, and I began studying. And then I won a scholarship to go to conservatory in San Francisco. And so it was 12 years from then. I starred opposite Plácido Domingo in Paris. Wow. So it was really amazing. Anyway, yeah, full circle. And this is my first time in New Orleans, and it's been a wonderful exploring. We haven't done too much because we've been in rehearsal, but we did have a chance to go to the French Quarter, and it's quite wild. I wasn't expecting that many people on a regular Monday night. You know, I guess that's normal here. Anyways, yeah, I'm excited to be a part of this cast. It's a wonderful, wonderful singer. The director is very, I love his ideas. And of course, our amazing conductor is, you know, I have to say something, I've never met a conductor that you really, with the chorus, he explains everything so clearly, and what he brings out of them in an instant, it's really inspiring. You know? And I'm looking forward to, you know, to getting on stage with the chorus and everything. It's gonna be a great night.
My name is Weston Hurt, and this is also my first time to New Orleans, and which is weird because I grew up in Houston, and it's just down the road. But I don't know why I never quite trekked across the state line, or at least this state line. I've been a lot of other places. I was born without my right hand. I don't know if any of you might have noticed. I don't have a right hand, and sometimes when I perform, I perform a variety of different characters that could have possibly lost their hand in war or battle or something. And then there are other characters that I portray where I wear a prosthesis. So I'm singing the role of Germont, which is Alfredo's father in this opera, and I will be wearing my prosthesis. So if you see me and you go, wait a minute, he has two hands, what in the world just happened? That is why. It does look very, very realistic. I freak out the maids in the hotel all the time. So I grew up in a family. My mother is a high school choir director. She's now retired. She teaches private piano and voice out of her home. But that was sort of my inspiration when I was younger. And sort of like Daniel, I joined choir sort of as a, well, my mom told me I had to, but it was also an easy credit. And I quickly found out, I don't know if you just look too shy to admit this, but there's a great ratio for men in chorus.
Okay.
Because there's a lot more women than there are guys. And so I quickly found out that, okay, this is a place I can hang out and have a good time. And so I was in choir, and then around my junior or senior year, sort of when things became more serious, and I grew up playing competitive sports. I swam competitively, I played football, I played lacrosse, and continued to play lacrosse even in college. But I took singing sort of initially in that same sort of competitive light, and initially was very much out to be better than the guy next to me. And so that competitiveness sort of got me through high school and into college, and then I very quickly learned it's much more about other things than just being better than the person next to you. But I had a wonderful experience in my freshman year. I went to Southwestern University in Georgetown, Texas, and it's a very small private liberal arts university. But they did have a current, or well, at that time, it was, he was the current voice teacher, but also the director of the Opera Theater Workshop. And whoever is in that position is sort of, however adventurous they may be, is sort of how whatever the program is. And he was a retired singer himself and wanted to present as much as he could in the small situation. So we went ahead and did the entire Mozart's Marriage of Figaro. And so at the age of 18, I had the opportunity to sing the title role of Figaro, the Marriage of Figaro. And that was my first time really being on stage. I had the opportunity my senior year in high school to do Into the Woods. My high school had a big musical theater program, and I was Cinderella's Prince in Into the Woods. That was the very first thing I did. But then my first venture into opera was the Marriage of Figaro. And so it was that for me that sort of like grabbed me and said, oh my gosh, this is, you know, incredible. You know, here's this 440-page score of music that made me, you know, cry and out of like frustration, thinking I could never memorize this whole thing. It's a comic, so I wasn't crying because of emotions. I was more just terrified at 18. How am I going to actually make this work? But from then on, you know, it was sort of a undenying sort of like passion and drive for me that got to the next step, to the next step, to the next step, and I'm so glad that it's led me here. And I've had the joy of working with Robert Lyall up in Michigan before a couple of times, and I have to second what Daniel was saying. It really is a treat to be able to work with Robert here, especially with this opera, but to watch him work with the chorus, to watch him work with us, and oftentimes I think certain conductors or directors might assume at a certain level, this doesn't need to be said, and then they don't say it, and then whatever kernel that might be is then missing from what it is that we put together. Because oftentimes, you know, we're here for a very short period of time, we've all performed these roles numerous times, and there might be sort of an assumption that, oh, I don't need to talk to you about this particular thing, or I might, you know, I assume that you know exactly what you're doing. But I love the fact that we get into in-depth studies and talks about who these characters are, how we can bring that out musically through the text, and I think at the end of the day, it presents a performance that's much more well-rounded and thought-provoking and complete. So it's always a pleasure to work with Maestro, and this is actually the first time I've worked with Gabrielle and James and Daniel and Carla. She's here today for the first day, and I'm just thrilled. So it's great to be here, and thank you so much for having me in New Orleans.
Well, I'm Carla. I am returning to New Orleans. Originally, I was born in Michigan, but my mother is Mexican, my father is Bulgarian. So I was kind of born into a state of cultural confusion. And, you know, it's been an interesting journey because, unlike a lot of my American colleagues, I did not grow up, you know, watching baseball games. I grew up listening to opera, and probably the first that really captured me is Carmen. So my favorite game to play as a kid was Carmen, and I would dress one brother up as the bullfighter and the little one as the bull. I'd get to play Carmen, of course.
Which institution are your brothers in?
Well, they went on to very smart jobs. Fortunately, I'm the one that stayed in that imaginary world. And so here I am today, right? But I really believe so much in this art form. I think I was drawn to it for two reasons. One, the power of the human voice to carry, to project the amplification over an orchestra, over chorus. And secondly, the beauty that a human being is capable of creating through their own body, through their voice. So it's been a dream come true for me to call myself an opera singer. I'm playing the role of Flora, who is Traviata's friend. Violetta's friend, I should say, and it's a special joy to work again with Maestro. He's, many of you probably know or have been a part of this, but he's someone who, in addition to all of the wonderful things that have been said, is very committed to young talent, and I know we worked together several years ago when I was still in school, and he gave me some of my first opportunities, both here in New Orleans as well as in Michigan. So I'm very grateful for that and grateful to have the chance to return.
Well, I think you all know who I am, but a couple of things in making observations about the comments you've heard. First, I love your choice of phrase in which you talk about the power of the silent form. Because when I listen to the career paths of my colleagues, all of whom arrived at this moment through sometimes similar, sometimes very different experiences, studying the flute, studying the cello, and then going to voice, being in musicals, that's a little closer to then go to opera. The ranchero music, the stories are the same as opera, Daniel, if you know. But the thing is, we all got here from some place. But the thing that is common and what excites us and that on which we feed is the power of the silent form. You know, when great voices come together with this great theater that the best operas have, with this magnificent music, then you have something that is very unique. And what is also very positive, I think, from the comments made, is that each of them found it at different points in their life, either through a parent or through their school or through colleagues. But young people can, in fact, be selectively drawn into this experience. And so there's always the future of the art form. Instead of feeling like we are dealing with historical subjects and treating them as historical experiences, the thing that I have encouraged them to talk about today in discussing their characters, the characters in Verdi's La Traviata were real people. You know, these are not fabricated characters. We know who Alexandre Dumas was, we know who Marie Duplessis was, which was the young lady that became the archetype. And of course, I want to return some of these compliments, having worked with several of these people. James brings a special kind of theatrical brilliance and insight to him. Such a highly intelligent person. I think starting to go up to opera at 6 is clearly what formed. just so that we can spend all of those hours, a minimum of 6 hours, sometimes 9 hours a day in a rehearsal room, hammering through the mechanics of the piece so that we can get it into a place where we can then apply expression to it. Requires a lot of understanding of who it is you're portraying, what the style of the piece is, all of these things. And everyone brings their educational background. But they have to bring two things that are God-given, and that is their talent and their heart. And you know, when you're in the room and you are working through these intricate scenes in which one emotion plays against another, that's where those two things step out, and you see exactly how a person approaches the understanding of how to use that voice, how to use that talent, make a statement that might be unique, might be fulfilling. So it's been gratifying to work with all of you, some of you over many years, but some of you more newly. But I will say this, that the story revolves around some central characters who are young and beautiful people. And I think if you look at Gabrielle Philiponet and Daniel Montenegro, at least we won in the modeling.
Were we chopped liver?
I was getting to the chopped liver. to have Weston bring that maturity and gravitas that the father must offer. And yet, at the same time, a sympathetic character. You know, this is what makes it fun. You know, the thing is, even at the end of exhausting hours of work, we leave the room feeling like we have touched something that is very special. And that is, any great operatic work, like Verdi's Traviata or Mozart or whomever, as I've often expressed, I feel privileged to be able to do what I do, to share thoughts and feelings about these masterpieces.
Okay, I've asked the cast now, starting from the beginning, walk us through the story of La Traviata. And actually, I would like Robert to start, because we start this opera with one of the biggest party scenes of all operas. But it actually starts with one of the most subtle, quiet overtures beforehand. Would you set that up?
Well, you know, there's a highly balanced structure here because the opening prelude and the prelude to Act 4 are virtually the same. And they represent Violetta's death. And so we don't know that, and I won't challenge James to answer right now as to whether the stage director chooses to also give us a theatrical presentation of prelude music, but that's very common in this, because it is so delicate, so translucent, and it's full of the mixture of these emotions, kind of a major, minor tonality, modality, because it deals with a tragic subject, and yet it has these shadowy musical echoes of the party music in it. So it's a little confusing. What is the emotion that is being played here? We're not talking about the traditional potpourri overture where you get famous themes from the opera that are played in some organic connection and it becomes a concert piece. We're talking about atmosphere. And so yes, it begins there, and that's what Todd is referencing. Then there is a great flash of brilliance. And that is, if you can imagine the luxury of the demi-monde, that half world of Parisian society in the late 18th, early 19th century, in which enormously wealthy men of aristocratic status maintained these beautiful girls in a truly luxuriant lifestyle consistent with a casino in your own home and truly the lap of luxury. It was decadent, yes. Was it prostitution? Well, certainly it brushes against it, but we would dignify it by calling them perhaps more just I don't know, what would the best word be? We use courtesan, we use things like escorts, we use words like this to keep it from sinking to the level below what that social order offered, because these were, as I say, barons, marquises, viscounts, people of that wealth and social station. Was it accepted? Well, it was certainly acknowledged by Parisian society. The best society of the church community would never have accepted it, but they were aware that it was there, and that is the lifestyle that was pursued, in which Violetta and Flora are players. So, with that, we start with a party at Violetta's house. The interesting thing, and I'll let Daniel talk about this, since he's the one who gets to share the narrative. Violetta has not been well for about a year. She's actually dying. What in opera we used to call consumption, today we call it tuberculosis, and today we have penicillin. But the and that would have changed the ending of the opera. Yeah. But she has been out of this brilliant social circle for some time, about a year, and convalescing, and now she has returned to the social program. And of course she did what every grand dame does, who is young and beautiful. She opens her home and says, invite everyone, we're going to have a great party. And so that's where we begin, and that's where these people meet.
So Alfredo, I believe he's, well, actually, his best friend of the moment is Gaston, and Gaston is more integrated in this society than Alfredo. Alfredo is a noble man, but he's more of the countryside. And Gaston, he's a regular at these parties, so he knows everybody at this party. Alfredo's still kind of like an outsider. And this party's going on, and obviously it's being thrown by Violetta, but it's using the Baron's money. It's at Is it at the Baron's?
No, it's at Violetta. It's Baron Dufault is the one who
pays for it, right? I guess it meant
who you argue.
Yeah. And Alfredo's an interesting character. He's very romantic, very passionate, but in a sense, he's very obsessive. This is a man who, I'm not sure if you've read the novel, but I mean, when he heard that she was dead, he wanted to see the body. I mean, what kind of man is that? You know? And he has gone to her house for a whole year, leaving a flower at her doorstep when he heard she was sick. Coming there, yes. So there we are at the party, and his friend Gastone finally introduces him to her, and of course he's already in love. He's been in love for a year, but there's something that it's within him that Violetta also falls in love with, and it's an instant love, I believe. It's pretty much, obviously, it's a love that Violetta has never experienced. She's never had somebody, or she's never fallen in love with somebody who hasn't, you know, been a status or, you know, or been able to, I guess, keep her. So it's a pure love, and there they are, and they find themselves together at last, alone. And he tells her, basically, that he's been coming to her house for over a year, and I can't believe that she didn't throw him out then. I mean, some obsessive man, but obviously she feels something as well. And although she knows it's probably not a good idea, she fights it in the beginning, but it's the love that she can't fight, and she gives it in the duet, and you can see that at the very end of the duet. And then my good friend Gaston comes in and interrupts us, and he says that we have to go because, you know, the night is ending. And she says, "You have to go, but take this flower." And he says, "Well, why?" He says, "Well, come back when it's dying. He says, "Well, it's almost dead already." Then she says, "Okay, tomorrow I'll come back." So he knows that it was a good night out. and that's the beginning. And then it ends with, obviously, the very famous aria. And you hear Alfredo in the distance, obviously singing his heart out. I don't know where you'd be like, you know,
actually, I'm Gabrielle now, since,
At the beginning, Violetta do her first party, and I think Alfredo, at the beginning,
one of many.
Yeah, another. He's handsome. Okay, and it's the only thing, a particular thing. She saw. At this moment, when we had the duet, the first duet. He told me, "I love you already since one year," and she understand at this moment that Alfredo loves her. Truly, sincerely, and not the courtesan, not the woman in the light, but the woman sick and the real the wheel woman. She's
say it in French.
Let me jump in and add a little bit of how Verdi's genius guides us. And that is, everyone in this room knows the famous Liviamo. It's a toast. Okay, so the friend of Alfredo says, let's have a toast. And he turns to the Baron, who is, of course, her patron, and says, won't you say something? And the Baron, who is pretty angry about what he's been seeing in the natural attraction between these young people, says, I don't speak in public. And so he turns to his friend Alfredo and says, then you offer the toast, and you're the master of that kind of tribute. And so where we first find out about the personalities of these two are the two different toasts that they give, because they're talking about love. And so you have his youthful ardor, his idealism, his sense of purity, and you have her rather more seasoned point of view that says love is really kind of frivolous, you know. So that's before we get to this duet that both of them have mentioned, which is of course also pivotal. But it also, I mention this only because to talk about Sempre Libera, which is also maybe the most famous aria in the opera, has to come from somewhere. And it comes from that duet, if you will, of Liviamo, their points of view about life, then their declarations of love, and then her decision. Do I want to change my life, or should I remain sempre libera? Should I remain forever free? And so the dilemma of the first act is those two or three steps there. And so Daniel has certainly explained it beautifully, as has Gabrielle, about who they are and where they come from. We just leaped over the Liviamo, which kind of sets the framework for the both the friction and the attraction between these two characters.
So the first act ends with Violetta saying, this is folly, this is ridiculous, there's no real love, I'm going to be free. And then the second act begins with them now living together. What happens in between?
Well, that's a big question. I think that one of the first and foremost things is that Violetta knows that she's very sick. She probably strongly suspects that she's dying. And you do have the historical, you have the novel on which the opera is based. You also have the Marie Duplessis, who is the sort of archetype, as Maestro mentioned earlier, for this character. But, you know, I believe in a lot of the historical research that I did about the piece, I think that there's some reason to suggest that perhaps she was raised also in the French countryside, and as a result of that had a sense of morality. One of the common sayings of the time is that, you know, God lives in the country and all evil lives in the city, and there was this sort of dichotomy, and that Paris was a city of gaiety and frivolity where four-fifths of the inhabitants died of grief and disease. And so to the extent that discrepancy was at work, I believe that the character was more than likely raised in a loving household to begin with. And then I kind of imagine that maybe her parents were deceased and she was maybe taken in by an abusive uncle or something and then had to flee to Paris. And so that when she's offered this particular brand of romantic love, of pure love, of sincere love, and she knows that she's dying, she ultimately has two options. She can either party herself to death or give in to this absolute saving grace of an offer of true, sincere love. And I think that that's what makes this one of Verdi's most personal operas and why it makes it my favorite opera of his personally. And so I think at the end of the day, I can't speak for everyone, you know, but I do think that the offer of this love does speak to her. And I think that there is a quality, you know, when you look at the items that were remaining in her home after she died, there was her bed, and there was also a prie-dieu, a kneeler. And I think that there was a sincere sort of return to a religious sincerity as well. That I think she has a line, you know, man may judge me, but God has forgiven all because I am sincerely penitent of my life. And I have given myself to love. And I think that there are a lot of strains, why I probably would digress if I went down that road about Verdi's personal living situation with after his personal wife died. So I won't really get into that now. But I think that she was ultimately faced with two choices and she chose love. And I think that's what makes it a beautiful piece.
In the second act is where we also meet Germont.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit more about who you are, because I think sometimes Germont's can be a little bit one-sided, and we can read them as being a little mean.
Yeah.
And so tell us a little bit about who he is for you.
For me, well, he's sort of changed. I have a 4-year-old daughter of my own. And becoming a parent, as I'm sure many of you understand, it changes how you see things. And I think that I've also, it sort of has coincided with being in different productions of this opera where we've almost fought against him being too mean. And so I've sort of always shared the compassionate side. When he comes in, he essentially is coming to see Violetta to ask her to disappear, to get out of their lives, because, as he claims, he has 2 children, and he has his other child is a daughter, and that daughter is going to be married, and he's afraid of the family that's marrying his daughter, what they would think if they found out that his son were to be living with and in a relationship with a courtesan. You know, I think it's at the end of the day up to the stage director and sort of that conversation that we have as an artist with the stage director, whether we want to portray that this idea is just another story, that none of it's true, and that this is a device that he creates to try to persuade her, or if indeed he does have 2 children and that he's being honest with her about this. You know, I tend to lean on the fact that, yeah, he actually does have a daughter, and he is truly fearful of what that would say, and he also has no idea what he's coming into. All he knows is that his son is off with some courtesan, in the lack of other words, right? So he comes to see her, and then he finds out, oh my gosh, this is not at all what I expected. And there's a couple of moments where he sort of comments on to himself about Violetta. And I think during the course of this 20-minute or so duet that Violetta and Germont share, he really does sort of, while he's there for a job and a purpose to get her to leave, he also sort of, I think that he has this dialogue in his mind of like, wow, if this were any other sort of situation and you weren't in the position that you were in, you know, he himself either sees love for her as a daughter or would love to have her with his son, you know, I don't know. So it's a struggle. What he's actually doing and what he's saying, yeah, it's mean. It's, I don't care if you're in love, get out. But at the same time, I think that, you know, there's also a other side to what he's saying. And he really begins, especially near, well, about the midway point, I think that he feels that he has great sort of admiration for her, and at the end of the day, I don't think it's one of those situations that he leaves sort of like, yes. I think it's more of a, wow, okay, well, hopefully that works and that everything's okay. I don't think that he wishes her badly, and I don't think that he enjoys doing what he has to do. At least that's how I see this character, and so I actually have to work hard to try to find the mean gruffness, and I think it's interesting, I haven't even talked to James about this, but there are moments that we've already sort of developed in the physical blocking of the scene, where he refuses to listen to her when she starts talking about, you can't do this, you can't pull him away from me, you can't tell me to leave him, because I have this and this and this. And initially when she begins to tell him, he sort of turns away and, that's not going to work on me. And there are a couple other things like that, but I'm really enjoying where so far we've taken this, and with getting a late start, we've only actually had the opportunity to run this a couple of times, so over the next few days, I think it's going to grow and take more shape. But yeah, I think that as a character, you know, only in his first appearance in the second act do we sort of see him as the bad guy. He comes in fact, well, I don't want to jump ahead too quickly, but I think that the next time you even see Germont, he's there scolding his son for how he's just seen him treat Violetta. And so I think from then on out, he's very, I think he's just interested in doing the right thing. And oftentimes that's unfortunate of the events that have to take place, I don't think that he's inherently a bad person or a mean guy. I think that he's just sort of trying to do what's right for the family and for him, and unfortunately that means at that time that they can't be together.
The next act then is Flora's, with the party that goes terribly wrong. So set us up kind of what the purpose of the party is, and then I want to talk to you about how you deal with particularly something like the big concertato there, and the ending of that.
Well, it's a party. What's the purpose of any party, right? To have fun. I think of Flora as she's the fun in this opera. There's a lot of gravitas, there's a lot of struggle, there's a lot of conflict. And it's fortunate for me because I get some really great music. But essentially, this is a scene in which it can be played different ways, but there's the women sort of take on these gypsy roles, and the men take on the matadors. So again, back to the Carmen reference, it's a lot of fun for me for that reason as well. And it's play. She has a whole little thing Flora does, which we were talking about yesterday also. It's sort of play acting. And then, you know, they weren't sure if Violetta was going to come. She does. And Alfredo also comes. And so we go back to the struggle.
And Violetta comes with?
The Baron.
Yes. Exactly. Talk to us about building this tension.
Yeah, I mean, you know, first of all, Verdi's music, when Violetta and the Baron come in, I mean, you can just feel the tension. It's just fantastic. And you know, there are definitely some productions where, you know, there's maybe some indication that Violetta has been hit or something by the Baron. We're not necessarily exploring, you know, that in particular, but there's definitely a sense in which the Baron's control over her at this point is extremely visceral and extremely present, and to the greater extent to which all of the men are essentially trying to control Violetta at this point, whether that be through money, whether that be through physical force, whether that be through love, public humiliation, and these kinds of things, and I mean what Verdi's done is really so masterful in terms of the psychological relationship between the Baron and Alfredo, and the way that the gambling scene plays out, I think, is extremely interesting. You know, as a director, one of the most terrifying things to do, especially earlier in your career, when there are these long, you know, pieces where each character is giving their own individual idea and the chorus is singing, is really just to trust the music, you know. I could certainly create staging, you know, I could create additional blocking and things like that to show those relationships, but ultimately Verdi is a master, and I serve Verdi at the end of the day, both in the concept and the spirit of what I believe that he was trying to achieve. And so yes, there is, I don't know how many minutes that period of music lasts, but it's what, 5 minutes or something. I mean, and it's glorious and it's gorgeous, and there's not really a lot of blocking. There are things that we do with lighting and you know, one of the great things about lighting is you not only manipulate what people are looking at, but you manipulate people's emotions through lighting, and I think that's really where I do a lot of that work. But yeah, I think that all of the music and everything that needs to be communicated is done purely musically, and that is dramatic. I mean, if the fight, for example, between Violetta and Alfredo, I mean, they're moving around the space, it's visceral, it's animalistic, it's vicious, you know. They love each other so much, but they can't be together. And so to have this moment where Alfredo throws the money at her, and then the chorus grabs him and pushes him aside really violently, and then Alfredo comes face to face with his father, who is that moral grounding. I mean, everything that needs to be said is done right there in pure structure of that scene.
Let's go to the last act. As Robert said, we start with the music from the prelude. And I think, in one of my opinion, probably one of the most touching moments when you read the letter. Tell us a little bit about what it's like to do something like that, about that letter, and how you get it.
This moment is for me the most difficult, because I want to cry really all the time, and it's difficult because if I cry really, I can't sing. For her, this letter is hope, because she knows that the father has a good opinion about her, and at this moment, like you say, she turned.
Yes, the conversion, yeah.
Yeah, and this letter, it's for her, and
I think in some senses, we'll give you just a minute. I think in some senses she already has the letter memorized. You know, she's read it so many times, and she's not, you know, reading it like this, you know. She reads the poetry of the letter, and she's read it 1,000 times.
Every 10 minutes she reads.
Absolutely.
And the music underneath it is the same as the love duet. It's being played underneath while she reads the letter. About the crying, I think it was Domingo who said one of the first times he sang Alfredo, when he came in the performance, he came in and saw her in the bed, and he started to cry, and he couldn't stop, because he like knew she was gonna die, and he couldn't get through the rest of the act, because he couldn't quit, because it was so real, and because the emotions set right there are so powerful. I want to open it to the floor for some questions.
How much digital projection do you anticipate using in this production, and how much physical scenery? Because it strikes me as an opera that really needs a lot of physical scenery.
It'll be entirely physical scenery.
Oh.
Yes, it's a very, very beautiful set. It looks like 1850s Paris, as are the costumes. It'll be very traditional, very elegant, and beautiful from top to bottom.
Is this the version where she lives?
She ascends, actually, into heaven.
Oh, you're all trash.
I actually had a great director during this one time who said, when she gets out of the bed and comes to him, everyone in that house better believe she's cute. They need to believe that she really is well. And then as she's going to him, fall. And then, because you want to be up, and then it just makes it even more tragic.
Yeah, yeah.
But you're not good.
Yeah. lines?
So I've seen the second act, in which Germont has been an extremely likable, warm character, and I've seen him work as just a mean people. You've sort of described a little bit towards the sympathetic side, but who makes that final decision? Is it your stage director, or
It's a solid conversation that happens, and we sort of agree on something together. I mean, at least I'd like to think of it that way from my side of the table. It's probably him, though.
Absolutely. I mean, we had a very brief conversation about the conflict in Act 3, what we're calling Act 3, between Alfredo and Germont. I mean, his father says, come back with me to the country. Like, please return to our family home, and Alfredo will have none of it. And so, you know, there's a certain amount of backstory that, you know, I think one compelling argument or suggestion is that Germont acts as this sort of moral mouthpiece throughout, and was, you know, raised Alfredo in a very specific way. But I sort of think that maybe Alfredo witnessed his father engaged in some kind of activity that was very much in conflict with how he had been raised. And, you know, sort of like Willy Loman in Death of a Salesman. You know, when his children. Their view of who their father was shattered by realizing he had been having this affair. I'm not saying that it was specifically an affair, but something definitely transpired in that backstory for me.
Do as I say, not as I do.
Right,
kind
exactly.
Of, kind of thing.
Well, he reinforces that
He's
point.
Human.
It's interesting. Espresso Daniel is a perfect example. He's talked Violetta out of this relationship based on a moral principle, that is, our family's honor is at stake. And she agrees. He pleads with his son to come home. But when he steps into that party, and the timing is so exquisite, and sees his son throw that money in her face, you know, that I think, I'm assuming everyone in the room knows the plot, you know, that Alfredo wins a lot of money from the Baron. And then he calls everyone together and says, do you know this lady? And they all say, well, of course we do. Do you know what she's done? She supported me, and now I'm going to pay her back. And as an act of dishonor, he throws this money very angrily in her face. That's what the father witnesses, and that's what the father says. No true man ever does that. You see, so however many backstories there are, at least for that pillar of virtue that Germont represents, he's willing. He could have walked in and said, son, you treated her exactly the way I wanted you to.
Right.
Now, I told you, come home to Provence. You
know? Right.
Instead, he says, I don't care what the circumstances are, honor and nobility above everything, and what you have done is shame.
And he goes even further to say that I don't even see my son in you anymore. You know, where has the man that I know as my son, where has he gone?
So he's an interesting figure, and he might be brutal in some stagings in the duet with Violetta to make his point. But at least if that is the true Germont, then we want to walk away from the theater thinking he is a noble person. The letter, of course, clarifies it even more. Remember, the letter is an apology to Violetta for having asked her to make the sacrifice that she made. And he says, I was wrong. No one should ever step between two people who are in love and try to obstruct that for some ulterior motive. So we get lots of layering in about the moral, the integrity of the man.
Right.
And at least, the conflict between father and son is probably pretty natural. I'm just doing this to protect you, I'm just doing this to protect the family. But
right.
But in the larger scheme of things, I think what Germont does is all really tilted toward the nobility, the noble gesture.
I want to, the ladies I'm sure are ready for us to come across, but like on the point that Randy just said, and this is something that we talked about in your interview, is that this cast is the first time this cast has ever worked together. So this is the first time that the director and the conductor and every one of these characters have come together. And I don't think in any situation, although I do know some directors are this way, that it always is a finding of uniqueness, because every one of you have a unique background with the role. And every time you get into a live theater situation, it will never be the same. And that's really what makes live theater unique, is that if the cast has never sung together as a whole, they've never been in this as a new production as a whole. So everything about this is new and fresh. So even if you've seen 100 Traviatas before, you have never seen this one. So I think we're set to have a fantastic production. Thank you all again for coming. And thank you all for coming. And let us all.